there's a secret programming language that runs inside every smartphone, plane, power grid control system. A language almost no new software engineer is taught, but one that keeps our modern world buzzing. Yes, we have critical infrastructure that is technically powered by code that only a dwindling few can understand. This is assembly. This language is cryptic, brutally hard to master, but at the same time, pretty epic. And without it, modern technology just wouldn't be the same. In an era where programmers learn Python or Java, assembly has become quite a secret. Assembly is rarely seen by everyday coders, and this is because it is a low-level programming language, whereas a lot of programming languages now are high-level programming languages. Before I get too deep, let's just clear up what exactly low-level and high-level means. Think of it like this. High-level languages like Python, C# or Java, well, they are designed for humans. They're closer to English, they're easy to read, and they hide all of the messy details of how the computer actually works. They technically let you say, "Hey computer, calculate this," without actually worrying about what's under the hood. Low-level languages, on the other hand, are designed for the machine. Assembly is one of them. They don't care about readability or convenience. They care about talking directly to the hardware, the CPU, the memory, the registers. So, a high-level language is like telling the chef, "Hey, make me a sandwich." Whereas a low-level language is giving step-by-step instructions. Pick up the bread, spread the butter, put the cheese in, close the sandwich. Consider the statement x equals x plus 1, where x can be any value. On Python, this would be x equals x plus 1. Looks simple enough. But in assembly, that's a bit different. You'd be staring at something like this. However, the nice thing about assembly is that it is the truth of the matter. The commands or statements on assembly map one-to-one to what the computer actually does. Assembly is really as close to talking to the hardware as you can get. So how on earth does something like assembly come into existence? To understand the mystique around assembly, let's travel back to the dawn of the computer age, which is actually relatively recent. It's the 1940s. Back then, there were no keyboards, no screens, not even the idea of software as we know it now. Programming meant literally flipping physical switches on giant panels to enter binary instructions, rows of ones and zeros. And that was entered directly into the machine's memory. Some computers used plug boards where engineers would reroute wires to change what the computer does. Others relied on punched cards, where the holes in the patterns actually represented the numeric code. And each hole told the computer to perform the tiniest operations, move data from one place to another, add one number to another, etc. So at this stage, the idea of programming was just painfully slow. Well, enter Kathleen Booth, a pioneering computer scientist in 1947. She's credited with inventing the concept of assembly language. So assembly introduced short symbolic code called mnemonics, and these actually represented those numeric instructions to the machine. So instead of remembering that 10110000 means load a register, a programmer could write the statement LDA, which is the mnemonic, and then the computer would load the register. And this was a revolution because it freed programmers from writing pure binary code, which saved a lot of time. Once that was established, well, early examples quickly followed. In 1949, we had something called the EDSAC or EDSAC computer. This computer was built to be a general purpose scientific calculator. It was a giant number cruncher for the University of Cambridge. Now, before computers like this, scientists and mathematicians actually had to rely on hand calculations or even mechanical adding machines for their research, and this was slow and tedious. Well, the EDSAC changed that. It could store about 1,024 words of data, which is tiny by today's standards, but at that time it was pretty large, and it just processed instructions through thousands of vacuum tubes. And at first, programming the EDSAC meant entering long strings of numeric code directly into the machine. And each of this represented a single operation: add, subtract, load, store, things like that. And it was really brutal because one small mistake in a number meant that the whole program failed. That's when a man called David Wheeler entered, and he created what's now recognized as the first assembly program. And it was a piece of software that let programmers write instructions using letters instead of numbers. And each instruction had a single letter mnemonic, like A was for add, S was for subtract, T was for transfer, and so on. And now, instead of memorizing all those binary codes, a programmer could just type in these shorthand codes, and Wheeler's assembly program would automatically translate them into machine code so that the EDSAC can understand that. This saved a lot of time and effort, and by the 1950s, 1960s, assembly language was everywhere. It was a language to use for early mainframes and mini computers. If you were a programmer in those days, you would have lived and breathed in assembly. But you had to, because at that stage, there were no compilers for C++ or even Python yet. At this stage, companies like IBM distributed their computers with manuals of thick assembly instructions. And assembly was used for everything: business applications, scientific calculations, even games. In fact, many of the first video games, like Space War, were written in assembly because nothing else could have direct control of the hardware needed for the game to actually be used. But even during that time, high-level languages started popping up, like Fortran. This was around the 1950s. And these languages offered a more English-like syntax for programming. And by the late 1950s, developers, who are just a lazy, lazy bunch, they noticed that it was far more productive to write in these high-level languages, like a COBOL or Fortran, and then have a compiler, essentially a translator, to translate it down to assembly or machine code. And that's when assembly started getting the reputation of it being difficult and low level. So as the 1960s, 1970s rolled on, that golden age of assembly just began to fade, and people started favoring the higher level languages more. But still, one of the greatest triumphs of assembly is that it literally reached the moon. In 1969, Apollo 11 astronauts took humanity's first steps on the moon. And they got there with the help of a tiny onboard computer known as the AGC, or the Apollo Guidance Computer. This was essentially programmed in assembly, but again, still had the reputation of being just difficult to understand. So by the 1980s, if you were writing business applications or doing a university project, you'd most likely use something like C or Pascal. And assembly was now mainly for specialists and system programmers. It was just no longer mainstream in the programming community. But it was far from gone, maybe just hidden. Fast forward to today. So if you walk into a computer science class at a modern university, you might never encounter assembly language at all. As one Stanford professor noted, many top students graduate in computer science without ever really understanding what goes on 3 to 4 layers down in the computer. Generally, if you are a programmer nowadays, you would learn high-level languages, work with cloud platforms, maybe write some JavaScript or Python, all quite far removed from the actual metal. At the same time, why teach something that is so rare when most jobs are in application development, web programming, AI, etc., and all of them use higher level tools? And it's a fair question, because assembly is hard. It's unforgiving. One mistake with an assembly instruction really low down can crash an entire system. It's also hard to read and maintain. In modern languages, you know, you might see a line with comments that clearly are labeled calculate interest rate. In assembly, all you get is cryptic codes that look meaningless unless you know exactly how the computer's brain works. And to be honest, these days, we don't really need to bother with that level of detail. We have fast processors, we have really smart compilers, and these computers can take our high-level code, you know, written in languages like Python, and automatically turn it into efficient machine instructions without us getting involved. But because of this, there is a result, and the result is that fewer and fewer programmers have been taught assembly as a core skill. It's often just a niche elective in universities. But is that a problem? Because the world definitely still runs on it. At the core of an operating system that anyone uses lies assembly. Your Windows PC, your Mac, your Android phone, when they boot up, the first thing they run isn't some high-level script. It's firmware that's often written in assembly, and that firmware just kickstarts all of the hardware. And once that's done, then it hands over control to the operating system kernel. So operating systems very much still rely on assembly. Embedded systems also rely on assembly. So embedded systems are tiny computers, and they may not look like any computers at all. So if you think about a microcontroller in a microwave oven, or the chip inside a pacemaker, these systems often have quite severe constraints. They have limited memory, very modest processors, and just a need for real-time response. And for these embedded systems, assembly language shines. In fact, there was a study that found 75% of embedded system developers use assembly for at least part of their code. And the reason why assembly is still being used is quite similar to the early days. In an embedded system, you have maybe 8 kilobytes of RAM, a very small CPU. High-level languages would be too inefficient for that. They won't be able to handle it. Assembly just gives you that precise control so you can squeeze into that tight memory and actually meet the strict timing. So assembly language is still very much used today. There is a sense of concern. We've gradually let our understanding of this fundamental programming language fade away within the broader programming community. The problem is the people who thoroughly understand assembly are getting older, they are retiring and they're moving on, and there are fewer younger developers to replace them. In fact, a computer expert commented that each year, even the nerds get further away from the reality of what's going on inside a computer. Layers and layers of user-friendly technology have made it so that you can be a perfectly capable software engineer without even ever considering what exactly the CPU is doing. And most of the time, that's fine until it isn't. There have been several real-world issues that highlight the fragility of not having enough skilled developers for your older programming languages. For example, in 2020, during the COVID crisis in the USA, there was a large amount of unemployment claims, and the system that you use to track the claims relied on COBOL. And because of the large volume, there was issues with the system, and unfortunately, there were not enough COBOL engineers to fix it. So issues like this pop up not as often, but they do. And when they do, it really is chaotic. But that said, it's not an apocalyptic scenario. There are still specialists in assembly. There are also specialists being trained. There are universities who are still teaching assembly as well, especially for how computers work at the lower level. So it's not going away entirely. And also, as long as compilers exist, we still have indirect ways to deal with assembly. And maybe the future of assembly is just for it to become an internal implementation detail, something that only compilers or even AI would deal with. But even in that scenario, you would still need an expert to be able to write the compilers, design the processes, deal with bugs, etc. It's always just humbling to know that no matter how fancy programming languages are now, we still can't get rid of code that was written decades ago because it works. Thanks so much for watching. If you like my content, please like, comment, and subscribe. I'll see you on the next one.